We thought our drug was different because not only does it work peripherally in the lung, it works centrally at the brain, which mediates coughing and breathing. So we pivoted and we are now buckled down in sort of three cough indications specifically.
All right, welcome back inside our proactive newsroom. And joining me now is Jennifer Good. She is the CEO of Trevi Therapeutics. And Jennifer, it's good to see you. How are you?
I'm good. Thanks for having me, Steve. I appreciate it.
Yeah, excited to learn a bit more about what the company's up to. I know you've had some recent news, and we'll talk about that in just a second. But maybe just for people not familiar with the company, give me a bit of background on you.
Yeah, so I'm one of the two co-founders of Trevi Therapeutics. We founded it about 10 years ago. We had worked on this compound, Nalbuphine, in my prior company I was running, and that company was acquired, bought the compound out, and Dr. Tom Sciascia, who's a neurologist, and I started pursuing its potential applications and some different indications and sort of find ourselves here. And I sort of joke, I think we finally found a good home for our child. It seems to be off and running.
Yeah, tell me a bit about your child and the compound and how it works.
Yeah, so the drug is a drug. It's an old drug called Nalbuphine. What we did at the prior company that I ran is it was a drug that was only available as a sub-Q injection for acute indications, but it had a lot of interesting properties. It's broadly in the opioid class, which, today is a bad word and everybody sort of runs from. And it was even then when we got interested in it. The reason we were interested in it is there's a subcategory of opioids called mixed agonist-antagonist that were developed in the 80s to deal with drug addiction. And so what they do is they block that mu receptor, which is where you get the addiction and likability properties, and agonizes at the kappa receptor. So it brings a lot of the benefits of opioids, which tend to be strong efficacy and good long-term safety, and gets you away from that likability addiction issue. So we started reviewing indications where opioid biology played an important role outside of pain, and how we could bring this molecule without bringing with it all the addiction baggage.
Yeah, so you've put this into properties now, and I know you've done a number of clinical trials. So talk to me about sort of the pipeline and where that's at.
Yeah, so we found our way. There were two sort of paths we started off on when the company originated. Both fundamentally fall into the category of hypersensitization disorder. So one was severe skin conditions caused by itching. And so the skin would get hypersensitized and would form nodules or sort of different indications there. We actually had two positive trials there. At the same time in 2022, we were looking at neurological cough conditions. So importantly, cough sort of falls in two buckets. Productive cough, so when you have a cold and you're coughing things out of your lungs, we're not working there because you don't want to interfere with that process. But there's a lot of different indications that create sort of a neurological response, which is more of a feedback mechanism of coughing that really has nothing to do with clearing your lungs. And so that's fundamentally hypersensitization at the brainstem. And so we also reported out very good data there. That had been a category that a lot of drugs had been tried and failed because mostly they were working on peripheral mechanisms in the lung. We thought our drug was different because not only does it work peripherally in the lung, it works centrally at the brain, which mediates coughing and breathing. So we pivoted and we are now buckled down in sort of three cough indications specifically.
Yeah. Is that deal with chronic cough, with IPF and RCC? Those are the ones that you're sort of concentrating on now. And I know you've just had the data from phase 2A. So where does this go from here now?
Yep. So that's right. We have three legs of the stool. There's interstitial lung diseases, which is IPF and sort of all the rest of ILDs, and then RCC, refractory chronic cough. So you're right. We just reported out phase 2A data in refractory chronic cough. That had been an indication where there were probably 25 drugs that had failed. A lot of big pharma has been tried there. And there was also the one drug who's sort of in phase 3 and making its way, hopefully, to the market for patients, only works peripherally and only works in a small group of patients, the most severe enriched patients. The whole rest of this patient group, which is large, 2 to 3 million, does not get any relief. So we put up data, worked in everybody across all cough counts, and there was a very large effect size that all came on in the first week. So very quick action for patients, worked in everybody in a big effect. So, and we're talking about patients here, by the way. We had someone in our trial that coughed 3,500 times a day. So this isn't like we think about cough where you have sort of a cough that's annoying. These are people that it's ruining their lives. So where we go from here, we just ran a phase 2A. Clearly, the drug works in a 2A proof of concept trial. We're moving on to phase 2B, which is a dose ranging study to try and dial in the dose. And then from there, because this will be actually an sNDA, a follow-on to our lead indication, we believe we only have to run one pivotal study. So it's a dose ranging, a pivotal study, and hopefully we can file.
So Jennifer, when I was recently reading your financial numbers, it showed that you had a cash runway into 2026. So tell me what the second half of the year is going to look like for you. Is it mainly focusing on that study you just talked about?
That study we read out, and we will continue to advance that into phase 2B. We do have our lead indication and IPF reading out in the second quarter. So that's exciting for us. With that data, we hope to get an end of phase 2 meeting with the agency and agree to our phase 3 program, which we plan to run in parallel next year. Specifically, tying it back to your cash question, we have enough cash to finish all the work we're doing now, as well as that phase 2B and RCC. We will at some point need to raise money to finish up our IPF program, but our cash gets us into the second half of 2026. So whether we do that on data or after we talk to the agency, we'll sort of sort that out as we get there.
Wow, exciting times ahead, it sounds like for sure. Jennifer, thank you so much. Great to catch up with you and good luck. I know the work you're doing is extremely important, so we look forward to following all your successes. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Steve.
All right, there's Jennifer Good, the CEO of Trevi Therapeutics.